Joe, right there.
You guys sure are snappy.
They look after us on this show.
You know, you guys are really too much, and I want to introduce you to the guys individually in The Who, because you never get to know their names. You know them as The Who. Everybody says, who? And you say, you know. What's your name?
Pete. Townshend, yeah.
Pete, and where are you from, Pete?
London.
From London?
Yeah.
London where?
London, England.
Hey, where'd you learn to play, you know, that's a wild style of playing. Where'd you learn to play the guitar like that?
That was bowling. Bowling.
Bowling. Yeah, I could tell. Now we move right along. Right over here. Right over here. And you're
John.
You're John?
John.
And you're from
London, sir.
From London too?
Yeah.
And you must be Roger.
I must be.
Who are you?
Yeah.
You're Roger?
I'm Roger.
And where are you from?
Oz.
Roger. Here's Roger from Oz. And over here, the guy plays the sloppy drums. Follow the yellow brick road. What's your name?
Keith.
Keith?
My friends call me Keith. You can call me John.
Okay, John. I just soon call you Roger. Roger from Oz. What's the next song you're going to do?
My Generation.
Your Generation?
Yeah.
Well, I can really identify with that because I really identify with these guys. I dig them. And this is a...
You've got sloppy stage hands around
here. Okay, that's enough! They're going to sing My Generation. This song really goes, and you're going to be surprised what happens because this is excitement, and hit it. My Generation.
People try to put us to talk about my generation
just because we can.
Talking about my generation,
things ain't cool at all.
Talking about my generation,
I might die before I get old.
Talking about my generation,
my generation. Don't you all fade
talking
away
about my generation.
Try and dig what we all
talking about my generation.
Try to cause a
talking about my generation.
Talking about my don't you all fade away? Don't try and dig what we all
talking about my generation.
Trying to cause a big sensation. Talking about my generation. It's my generation, baby. My generation. We'll be right back.
Dick. I'd like to borrow your bass for a minute.
And now, here is your shindig host, Jimmy O'Neill.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Howdy, ha, shindiggers. Well, tonight is our very last shindig, and we're going out with a bang. And boy, we got a bang-up cast for you, starring Billy J. Kramer and the Dakotas, The Who, Dave Barry, Ian Whitcomb, Sandy Shaw, The Kinks, The Baron Knights, Twinkle, and, of course, our own Blossoms in Wellington. So what do you say we get ready to live it up? Because here we go with our kickoff tune tonight called I Can't Explain, and here to sing it are The Who.
Drape yourselves all over the upholstery.
Who does that machinery belong to? Does it belong to you or to us?
Bank.
I mean, who has to pay for it?
It's mortgage.
It's all right.
It looks all right.
It is my name. A lot of people live in them, you know. We've got 83 deposed.
Stop interrupting.
Barneys.
Who is
you
he?
Go on.
It's no good, no.
I've lost my nerve now.
All right, let me take over.
Oh,
now, you've been together now as a group for how many years? 10 years?
Yeah, I'm leaving.
Go in a minute. Hold on.
Was it that long? Christ almighty. Oh,
it's known as the decay of the Who.
Yes.
Was it the decay? The decline of the Who.
The decayed of the Who.
Oh, the decay.
Who, yeah.
Who decayed?
Thank you. Yeah.
ourselves together. You've been together for 10 years, a decade. You haven't yet decayed. Apart from the Rolling Stones, you're the longest surviving together group, are you not?
Well, not together.
What strains it, that you have suffered together, if at all?
Seems it's just beginning. It's such a long story. Shall I start in?
Yeah, start at the beginning.
Well, we started off as.
Small
the
family.
The fantastic thing about the Who is that we were all incredibly nasty.
You were.
Were. I mean, right. We're.
Still were. His feet are nasty as well, by the smell.
Oh, Christ.
Well, a young man ain't got nothing in the world these days. I said, a young man ain't got nothing in the world these days. You know, in the old days, when a young man was a strong man, all the people, they stepped back when a young man walked by. Nowadays, it's the old man, he's got all the money. And a young man ain't got nothing in the world to say. Hey, as I say, you know he ain't got nothing.
Of 1 week exactly 10 years ago.
Yeah.
when you had played at in that week at the Social Club in Goldhawk Road and the California Ballroom in Dunstable and the Railway Arms in Neasden, and what you'd made that week was £370. And what you'd spent was £1,946.17. And including £785 on replacement of guitars, drum kits and microphones. Who covered that gap in money, that £400 gap, which left £1,300 to find every week?
It's hard to say. I used to rush into Marshall's music shop and steal guitars off the wall. I'd say, just take any guitar, pay you Tuesday, and rush out. Kit Lambert, our manager, then, would sort of rush me, photographer from the Daily Mail and the audience, smash a guitar. He says, smash the guitar, move the state, and come back, Pete, sorry, you missed it. Can you smash another one? I'll give you the money. And as soon as I started smashing something up, Keith, who's a great sort of joiner in, he used to smash up his drum kit.
I suppose all his friends have been on here because, you know, I'm only one of several. I've told you about all the mad things he's done in life, such as, you know, breaking up rooms, driving his car into swimming pools, driving his car into foyers. Well, I'm not going to tell you about any of that. You know, I'm just here to tell you about the Keith I know and love, you know?
Keith, what's your opinion of your public image?
I think it sort of varies with every record I put out. I think sometimes could you get on with it? Will you keep it together? No, I think I'm very reliant on my management and my public relations people.
This country's in a weird, feeble, grotesque state, and it's about time it got out of it. And the reason it could get out of it is rock music. And I think that Townshend, The Who, Roger Daltrey, Entwistle, Moon could rise this country out of its decadent ambient state more than Wilson and those crappy people could ever hope to achieve.
Tommy, can you hear me? Can you feel me near you?
What about the little singer? What's your opinion of him?
Well, I think he does a damn good job out there. Personally, I mean, I wouldn't go out there up front with nothing to protect me but a small microphone. But he manages to like, revolve it so fast that, when people do throw things, he gets sort of desiccated egg and sliced tomato. I turn my cymbals up this way so that at the end of the night I have a salad mixed. I just sprinkle some salt and some Italian seasoning on it, and that sort of really ends up my evening here.
In general, see me, feel me, touch me, heal me, which reflect in a certain sense the phenomenon of youth subculture. There is narcissism, there is a kind of new sensibility, there's a strong tendency for playing up things and no more putting it into aggressive forms of a counteraction.
See me, feel me, touch me, heal me, see me, feel me, touch me. Thank you.
End of the 60s, that seemed to sum up an awful lot about rock. It was the time when, I mean, you were the great star of Woodstock. Woodstock itself was one of the biggest pop events in world terms because of the film that masses and millions of people had seen. And it was a marvellous thing in its way. But just as a matter of interest, what do you think it changed? What was different after it? What did that generation, all those people being given the same high by the same thing and yourself and so on, what did it change? I'm just interested to know.
Well, it changed me. I hated it.
ladies and gentlemen, The Who.
Resign yourself to the fact that a large part of the audience is sort of thick, you know, and don't appreciate quality, however much you try and put it over. The fact is that our group hasn't got any quality. It's just musical sensationalism. You do something big on the stage and 1,000 geezers sort of go, ah, it's just basic shepherd's bush enjoyment.
I can go any way we are choose. I can live anyhow we don't lose. I can go any way anywhere, anyhow, anywhere I choose. I can do anything but I want. I can talk anyhow we don't lose. Don't care anyway I never lose. Anywhere, anyhow, anywhere I
sound appeals to mods then it caters for aggression. For example, when for a brief period I stopped smashing guitars, kids started shouting out, smash your guitar Pete, smash your guitar, and getting quite annoyed that I wasn't, because to a large percentage of geezers that come to see the group, they paid their money to see me hit my amplifier with a guitar and see a guitar break, you know. A lot of girls come to see the group because of various things which people in the group wear, such as John's jacket and medals, and my jacket made out of flags, and Keith, who wears sort of fab gear, pop art t-shirts made out of targets and hearts and things like this. Because the group is a fairly simple form of pop art, we get a lot of audience this way. Off stage, the group get on terribly badly. There's a lot of despite and things which flash around. The singer's a shepherd's bush geezer who wants everything to be a big laugh, and when it isn't, you know, he thinks something's going wrong, terribly wrong. The drummer is a sort of completely different person to anyone else I've ever met. The bass player just doesn't seem to be interested in anything, you know, which makes it all very difficult.
If you've been together 10 years, you must have been subject to a great deal of strain and inattention.
No, yes.
And I now cannot ask
that. The thing was, actually...
We do try and ignore each other.
We've always been very close, you and I, haven't we?
No.
Well, one of the things that I've loved Pete Townshend is that Keith and I have been incredibly well, and I've hated him ever since I began. Since I've been doing the bulk of the writing, the thing is that he does no writing, and the thing is, of course, he keeps doing the lyrics.
Take up religion. Deserve to rock, to try to save.
shall play at Carnegie Hall.
I'm gonna give up my day job to become a heart thrub. I'll make your fall if I smash my guitar.
What about musical quality, though? You said that you didn't think your group had got any. Why don't you try and give it some?
But if you don't... If you steer clear of quality, you're all right, you know. No, really, this is the truth, you know.
But wouldn't you say the Beatles and people like that had a certain musical quality?
Ooh, you know, that's a tough question. I actually, this afternoon, John and I were listening to a stereo LP of the Beatles in which the voices come out of one side and the backing track comes out of the other. And when you actually hear the backing tracks of the Beatles without their voices, they're flipping loud.
Pictures of Lily, Lily, oh Lily, Lily, oh Lily. Pictures of Lily. Every day, just to drive to my baby. Throw them 10 sixpence each day, 'cause I drive my baby every way.
Magic horse, magic horse.
Major American tour was my bus. We travelled, went from coast to coast, and from Miami we'd go up to Canada. It was pretty awful. We used New York as a springboard. We used to play for Murray the K. We used to do 5 shows a day there, and we had 3 minutes to do our show. So we used to do 1.5 minutes of Can't Explain and 1.5 minutes of My Generation. Smash the guitar and run off, you know. 5 times a day, 7 days a week.
In those days, your performances used to end up with you smashing all your equipment. There were stories about you smashing hotel rooms on every tour you went on.
Not a word of truth.
Well, according to people at the time, it certainly was true. I mean, why was there all that violence surrounding you?
Well, this was only last week, wasn't it?
What made us first want to go to America and conquer it was being English. Not because we cared a monkey's about the American dream or about the American drug situation or about the dollars or anything. It's because we were English kids, right? And we wanted to go to America and beat it.
Pop music is crucial to today's art, and it's crucial that it should remain art, and it is crucial that it should progress as art.
Happy Jack wasn't old, but he wasn't there. He lived in the sand at the Isle of Man. The kids would all sing, he would take the wrong key. So they rode on his head in their furry donkey. Jack, they try and try and try. They drop things on his back. They lie, 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 lie. They couldn't stop Jack or the water stopping. And they couldn't prevent Jack from being happy. Stop Jack or the water's lapping. Then they couldn't prevent Jack from feeling happy. Jack, they drive, drive, drive. They drop things on his back. The line, 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 line. They couldn't stop Jack while the water's lapping. And they couldn't prevent Jack from being happy.
Came to see you mainly to look at the clothes you wear. Don't you think that most of them come for a certain sexual thrill they get out of your performance?
Look, you know, our group's probably one of the most unglamorous on the stage today, you know. I mean, no, really, I mean, this was one of our big problems, you know, and probably still is, you know, is that the group didn't have enough glamour. It was all, I mean, clothes and smashing things up, and it was all mechanical things. It was bricks and stones and things, and not enough sort of normal group things, you know. We made our second album, which he produced. And it was during that album, which, as I said, Kit Lambert produced, that we really realised what making albums was all about. You know, we had great fun, and it was very creative, and Kit was learning about record production and doing crazy things like recording the group from a microphone down the corridor and all these things, which are very commonplace nowadays, but using incredible amounts of compression and squeezing the sound up, squeezing cymbal sounds up to make them sound like steam engines, and various sort of twiddling knobs as the recording was going, and the engineers throwing their hands in the air. It's platinum coated knobs, mate, you can't do that. And all this was going on in the studio, but unfortunately we had 10 minutes on the album to fill when we'd finished. And so Kit turned around to me and said, I think you should write something linear, something with continuity, perhaps a 10-minute song. So I said, you can't write a 10-minute song. I mean, rock songs are 2 minutes 50 by tradition. It's one of the traditions, you know, they only allowed you one modulation, 4 chords or 5, you know, 5 chords. You might be up before the committee. 10 minutes. It's ridiculous. So he said, well, listen, if you can't write a 10-minute song, write a 10-minute story made up of 2-minute 50 songs, right, which I did. And that was the mini opera, it was called.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, dig the Who.
Two, three.
Her man's been gone for nigh on a year. He was due home yesterday, but he ain't here. Her man's been gone for nigh on a year. He was due home yesterday, but he ain't here.
Comes Ivor the dirty old sooty engine driver to make you feel all right.
Soon be home. Bang!
have to do is we have to decide whether or not we're going to remain the circus act, right?
Yeah.
Or whether we're going to, in other words, doing what everybody knows we can do and what we know we can do, right? Until the band eventually turns into a cabaret act, which is inevitable.
It's ridiculous to say that.
I mean, well, that's just
okay, Keith. Brandon Dry on the heel. Right.
I've heard a lot about you and the rest of the group taking drugs, Pete. Does this mean you're usually blocked up when you're actually on stage?
No, but it means we're blocked up all the time, you know.
Well, Keith, we've heard you drink a lot, but that's besides the point. If you could tell us, you know, I mean, how did you happen to join The Who? And if, in fact, that's what they were called when you joined?
Well, I've just been sitting in for the past 15 years. You know, they never actually told me that I was part of the band. I knew it by instinct.
Keith been rolled up one day, all ginger all over, ginger shoes, ginger corduroy trousers, ginger jacket, and his hair dyed ginger. Holding a glass of brown ale. So his complete ginger sort of vision came up and said, I can play better than him. And this horrible impudent with his hair down like this. And got up on the drummer's drum kit and practically smashed it to pieces. And we thought, this is the man for us.
Speaking to you for the Hewitt House Hotels, the rock star's home away from home. Don't be alarmed. I think I know what's going on.
Some information across before the fun and games break. Let's go. What were you before you kicked off with as a group?
He was almost as interesting as
the inland revenue.
You're what?
Inland revenue, income tax.
I think you said you're in a Land Rover.
He was in sometimes right. In the back.
In the inland revenue, income tax. Yeah. So what did you do?
Me? All sorts of things.
Like what?
Be more specific. He wants specific.
I want one thing that you did before you joined as a group. I mean, were you digging a garden or what?
Something.
He was born in a boat.
Sheet metal worker.
Sheet metal worker.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was a rust repairer. I was a rust repairer and full-time survivor. I survived all the major earthquakes. And a Titanic and several air crashes.
I think you'll have to give me a few lessons in survival, because if I'm going to survive this interview, I'll need a few lessons.
Oh, well, there is more brandy. Looking very worried.
Lemonade. Everything.
That's right.
And you were doing what?
Oh.
He didn't work.
Arty farty, he was.
Still leave me out of this. We're talking about me. Get out! Oh, no, no! Oh, no, King!
Oh! It's a breakup of the That's what he was doing, developing his muscles.
King! Leave me alone.
Well, they have to ask you this, you know.
I know, but...
You know, what do you think about Pete?
I love the man. He's one of my dearest friends. But I couldn't say, like, Ringo, if Pete said, what do you think about Ringo? I said, well, you know, we have our moments, and when we get together, there are certain times that you just... something happens, and I really don't know what it is, but there's that magic
it's
there.
Probably we're drunk.
It could be. What?
Not drunk, teeny boppers.
Absolutely not, you Donnie and Marie fans.
Keith had a lot of medicine.
Absolutely.
You know, just a lot of medicine.
We're getting on.
We're getting on now. We need our medicine.
Just see the age of the suit.
When I'm on the stage, let me try and explain. When I'm on the stage, I'm not in control of myself at all. I don't even know who I am. You know, I'm not this rational person that can sit here now and talk to you. If you walked on the stage with a microphone in the middle of a concert, I'd probably come close to killing you. I have come close to killing people that have walked on the stage. Abbie Hoffman walked on the stage at Woodstock and I nearly killed him with my guitar. A cameraman walked on the stage. A policeman came on when the bloody building at the Fillmore in New York was burning down. And I kicked him in the balls and sent him off, you know, because I'm just not there, really. It's not like being possessed, it's just... I do my job, and I know that I have to get into a certain state of mind to do it. We'll be right back.
the end of our tether. We'd reached it. We'd come upon the point when the... nosebleeds and all that. You know, they're no good. You can't go on doing it. It's no good. It's beyond the beyond.
Barbara,
where's Bob Rain?
Oh,
right.
Ambition now is to get back on the road with the horrible Who, the worst rock and roll group in the world.
The worst?
Yes. You couldn't pick four more horrible geezers that make the worst noise that you've ever heard in your life.
Oh, wow.
people try to put us down. Just because we get around. Things they do look awful cold.
Loud is because you get so many people sort of just turn deaf ears to what you do, you know what I mean? They sort of just won't listen to what you do, and it doesn't matter how good or bad it is. In fact, the bigger it is normally, the more they'll close their ears to it, and so the louder you've got to work, you know. And volume's a fantastic thing, power and volume.
When I went to get my ears tested, but it was really encouraging, apart from the fact he said I had
terrible
ears. He said, Bill said, well, what advice would you give him? Would you tell him to stop playing entirely and leave the group?
Throw his career out the window?
Would it become a pauper? Starve? Would you tell him that?
Well, no, actually, no, but I would advise him to learn to lip read.
It's true. That's what he said.
Have you all of you made enough money to stop work this afternoon tonight?
Goodbye and so you like that.
Yes, I have.
You have.
Why don't you stop then?
He's got to support me and the rest of the world.
You mean you've made more money than they have?
Well, I write.
Are you started to stop?
No, I write the songs. Yes. So if you write songs, you get a bit on the side, you know. You see, the thing is, as songwriter, I do have something,
No, carry on, Ross, will you?
No, I'm transfixed by it all. I don't know why I'm here, yeah.
In my generation, you wrote, I hope I die before I get old. Do you in fact mean it?
Yes.
Hey? There's a guitar up there. If any big mouth little git wants to come and fucking take it off me.
Rock
rock and roll's got no future, it don't matter.
We became rich a lot later than I expected. Now I'm too old to enjoy my money.
Excuse me. You know, we just shot a lot of film with the interview, and talking about all that, I was wondering,
heard the
now
word.
If you really tell us the truth and stuff, like...
I know. But, I mean, the truth is, you want to hear it? I can't do that. You couldn't afford me.
But you're a very different person now to the desperate young men of the early 60s, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm a desperate old fart now. Not boring, though.
Who are you?
So there.
I've been saving that.
You all behaved in this crazy way the whole time. You're all married, aren't you?
No. I wouldn't marry this lot.
It's a great sleeve, that.
It is, yeah.
If you touch my bleeding sleeve...
He's getting stroppy now. Yes, you leave his sleeves alone. Yeah. Personal them, eh? Can't touch the interviewer, can we? Hey, no, he's in command, didn't he? Can make everybody else look a right twit as long as you don't have a go at him. How long you been happily married, then, eh?
Have a long life.
Hear about the warts.
No, not too long. I should say about ladies and gentlemen, before my lifeline, according to him, is 2 minutes long, which means we've got to the end of the programme. We'll be back, God willing, well same time, done. Same place next week. See you then.
Always
good night.
So smooth.
This is where it all ends.
Just because we get around. Things they do look awful. Yeah, hope I die before I get old. This is my generation, baby. Why don't you all fade away? I said, yeah, don't try and dig what we all say.
anything to say.
Rock and roll's never ever stood dissecting and inspecting it at close range. It just doesn't stand up. So shut up.
There is a place for us.
I am accused of letting the side down, as it were, often by our fans. You know, you can't, for example, like you can't stop doing this. You can't stop doing what you're doing because you know you'd let down all these people. It's not people just saying, listen, you'll disappoint your fans if you don't go on. The show must go on. You know, you must go on, otherwise all those people will be so upset. It's, you've got to go on, man. Otherwise, all those kids, they'll be finished. They'll have nothing to live for. That's rock and roll.
Thank you.
Live don't mind.